your work is. So to complete today's festivities, let us briefly consider the origin and the devotion to Our Lady of Victories. How? Well, we got some illustration. The saints here in our main altar. I hope you know all of them by now. Okay. We have that series in our FB, remember? So let's begin here in the gospel side. Just behind me, over here, is St. Pius the Tenth. St. Pius the Tenth, as you know, is the patron of our small priestly society. Today, we're about 600 priests. Now, this society, St. Pius the Tenth, was founded by Bishop Marcel Lefebvre, and it was even canonically approved. It's not an official vacuum. It's canonically approved by Bishop François Charlier of Fribourg, Switzerland, on the 1st of November 1970. So mark the date, 1st of November next month will be a golden anniversary of it. Anyway, St. Pius X condemned modernism by his encyclical Pascendi on the 8th of September 1907. 1 month later, the 5th of October 1907, St. Pius X granted the canonical coronation of Our Lady of La Naval here in Manila. Why? Because it is intercession that our country, the Philippines, was saved from the Protestant invasions. Plural. Why? Because it was the Dutch and the British who wanted us to become Protestants. And that was in the 17th century. Moving on, the next statue over there is St. Pius V. In 1517, Martin Luther in Germany started the Protestant Revolution. He is the father of Protestantism. Meanwhile, in Eastern Europe, the Muslim Turks were trying to invade 1570. So, St. Pius V, the one holding the crucifix, he organized a holy league among Catholic kingdoms, the United Catholic Kingdoms, but France did not join. In any case, because of this organization, there took place a naval battle between the Catholics against the Muslims, and it happened in the Gulf of Patras near the island of Lepanto in Greece in the 7th of October 1521. So that was a few months after Pagella came here to the Philippines. He came here on March 21, October 21, the Battle of Lepanto. That morning, the wind was against the Christian values. Meanwhile, in Rome, St. Pius V led the rosary procession. By midday that day, October 7, 1521, the wind changed its direction in favor of the Catholic League. So around 4 o'clock that afternoon, the Pope interrupted his study. And he looked outside the window. And then he told his secretaries, "Let us thank God and the Blessed Virgin Mary for the victory." The secretaries were looking at each other, "What victory?" Well, his prophecy was confirmed on the following 22nd of October, when the official messenger from Lepanto arrived at Rome. And so in gratitude to Our Lady, St. Pius V instituted the feast of Our Lady of Victory. Singular. And he Lady of Victory to Our Lady of the Most Holy Rosary, and even transfer the feast day to the first Sunday of October. But Our Lady was not content with one victory. Through her rosary, there were other victories that she gave to the Christian world. In 1601 in Hungary, 1646 here in Manila, the famous Battle of Lalaban, in 1683 in Vienna in Austria, and many others. And that is why, from the singular Our Lady of Victory, she is called Our Lady of Victories, plural. Now, what about St. Pius X? In 1913, when St. Pius X reformed our liturgy, he restored the feast of Our Lady of Victories to its original day, October 7. Okay. Now, after the crucifixion, let's go to the episode side. The episode side, we got there, St. Athanasius of Alexandria. St. Athanasius upheld the true Catholic faith in the divinity of our Lord Jesus Christ already at the Council of Nicaea in 325 AD. Unfortunately, after the Council of Nicaea, most bishops became Arian heretics. Imagine bishops denying the faith. Yes, it did happen. And so St. Athanasius was condemned by his fellow bishops. And the Christian emperors, also the Catholics, heretics though, exiled him four times for St. Athanasius. And to put the cherry on top of the pie, the Pope himself, who favored the semi-Arian heresies, Pope Liberius, yes, it happened. However, St. Athanasius did not only defend the divinity of our Lord, he also defended the crucial role of the Blessed Virgin Mary in the incarnation of Christ. Now, curiously enough, in the recent history of the world, our founder, Archbishop Lefebvre, was also ostracized by the French and most Catholic bishops. Archbishop Lefebvre was even illicitly excommunicated by John Paul II in 1988. However, his successor, Benedict XVI, lifted up without her asking this illicit excommunication in 2007. So there you are, friends. History repeats itself in front of our very eyes. So today, we are here 2020. The enemies of the church continue to attack her. We must be aware of that by now. Now, dear friends, if we are the loyal children of the church, we cannot just let our mother, the church, be insulted, humiliated, degraded. No. If we are children of the church, we must not be passive onlookers. We must be active. church militant. And our general is the Blessed Virgin Mary. She leads us to battle. However, who could be our model for this true devotion to Mary? Let us turn here at William Stable, St. Therese of the Child Jesus. Why St. Therese? Because when she was 4 years old, her mother died with cancer. So she asked the Blessed Virgin Mary to become her own mother. And Our Lady fulfilled her role. When Therese was 10 years old, she had this mysterious sickness, which is borderline with psychosis. Para sa mga baliw? Yes. And the doctors gave up on her. She got constant headaches, terrible hallucinations. The doctors gave up on her. In desperation, her father and her sisters asked for a novena of masses there at the Basilica of Our Lady of Victories in Paris, France. During that novena of masses, it was the afternoon, the 30th of May, 1883. That day, Therese was hallucinating, and then she was completely paralyzed. She could not move in her bed, and she could not talk anymore. The only thing she can move is her eyes. So with her eyes filled with tears, she looked at the statue of Our Lady near her bed and prayed silently. But then, suddenly, the statue of Our Lady became alive. And Our Lady smiled at little Therese. But from that day on, she recovered until complete recovery. See? 5 years later, in November 1877, on her way to Rome, Therese stopped at Paris. You know where she went? She went to the Basilica of Our Lady of Victories to thank Our Lady for her cure. So, there is absolutely no problem, no struggle that the Blessed Virgin Mary is not able to help us or cannot give us victory. Why? Because the Blessed Virgin Mary is not just there in Paris, or inside our church. The Blessed Virgin Mary is only a rosary away from each one of us. And by the way, that statue of Our Lady of Victories on top of the main altar, that is copied from the Basilica of Our Lady of Victories in Paris, the one that St. Therese venerated. But you felt some of you might object, Father, I am so distracted with St. Rosary. Well, here's a word of consolation. Listen to what St. Therese wrote 4 months before she died. She said, "When I am alone, I am ashamed to admit it, the recitation satisfied with it. Let us then, dear friends, prove our goodwill to the Blessed Virgin Mary. Like St. Therese, with all the distractions, love of concentration, let us persevere in praying our family rosary. Because in praying the rosary, we may imitate the virtues that they contain and obtain the graces that they promise. Therefore, this main altar of Our Lady of Victories, Quezon City, is a lesson and a challenge for each one of us who comes here. St. Pius the Death crowned Our Lady of Lalabal and restored the day of her feast. St. Pius the Fifth instituted the feast in thanksgiving for the victory of the Pope. St. Athanasius defended our Lord's divinity and Our Lady's role against the heretics. As for St. Therese, she reminds us that Our Lady is more a mother than a queen. The Blessed Virgin Mary is more our mother than our queen. She